Good morning, students. Today I will teach you about features of treatment in psychiatry. Now coming to what are the treatment modalities in psychiatry. The various treatment modalities in psychiatry are psychotherapy, physical therapies, milieu therapy, therapeutic community and activity therapy. What are the somatic or physical therapies? Then are the psychopharmacology, ECT or electroconvulsive therapy, which is in layman term is known as shock therapy, and psychosurgery means brain surgery. What are the psychopharmacology, somatic therapies? They are the drugs used in psychiatry as called as psychotropic or psychoactive drugs. They are classified under antipsychotics, antidepressants, mood stabilizing drugs, anxiolytics and hypnosedatives, anti-epileptic drugs, anti-Parkinsonian drugs, miscellaneous drugs which include stimulants, drugs used in eating disorders, de-addiction, child psychiatry, vitamins, calcium channel blockers, etc. Antipsychotics are used for the treatment of psychotic symptoms. These are also known as neuroleptics. The classification are They are classified in two right now. It's first generation antipsychotic and second generation antipsychotic. But recently there is another group which is known as third generation or antipsychotic or novel antipsychotics. The first antipsychotic to be introduced in the market or discovered was clopromazine in the year 1952, which started a wrong range of antipsychotics. The second drug to be introduced or to be discovered was clozapine, which is a second generation antipsychotic. In the first generation antipsychotics, the difference in first generation and second generation antipsychotics are, in first generation antipsychotics, they lock more of EPS or extrapyramidal symptoms, while second generation antipsychotics is less than EPS, but their metabolic and symptoms of the metabolic symptoms are way more. Side effects in diabetes and all, the second generation antipsychotics are more harmful than the first generation antipsychotics. The first generation antipsychotics are clopromazine, prochlorperazine, thioridazine, fluphenazine, haloperidol, pimozide, and thiothixin. While the second generation antipsychotics are aripiprazole, olanzapine, quetiapine, risperidone, paliperidone, acetapine, clozapine, iloperidone, lulasidone, and ziprasidone. The indication of antipsychotic drugs are given in organic psychiatric disorder like delirium, dementia, delirium tremens, drug-induced psychosis. In psychotic disorders like schizophrenia, mania, major depression with psychotic symptoms. And in childhood disorders like ADHD or attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, autism, conduct disorder, medical disorders or tic disorder. This is the pathway, this is the pharmacology, how the drug act. You have seen the neuroleptic cleft, there is the axonal and the axosomatic here, where there are neurotransmitters in the synaptic cleft. These neurotransmitters are help in the transmission of in the D2 receptors, which is known as, which goes from the nucleus accumbens to the pons area, to the medulla oblongata area, which is PO2 and D2 antagonist. These are the T2 antagonists which work and help in increasing the dopamine level in the brain, and that's why this work in schizophrenia. These are the positive symptoms, and in normal in decreased as there's more neurotransmitters here, more dopamine level is increased because there is a D2 antagonist. There is a reduction in the positive symptoms of the disease. The extrapyramidal symptoms, EPS, which is very common in second generation antipsychotics. There are three types: neuroleptic induced Parkinsonism, acute dystonia, and akathisia. In Parkinson's symptoms, there will be rigidity, tremors, bradykinesia, drooling. The disorder can be treated with anticholinergic agents. In acute dystonia, there were dystonic movements arise from a slow, sustained muscular spasm that lead to an involuntary movement. Dystonia can involve the neck, jaw, tongue, and the entire body. As you see here, in Parkinsonism, why there is Parkinsonism? Because Parkinson happens when there is decrease in the dopamine level, decrease in the dopamine level in the brain. While what the antipsychotic does, the antipsychotic also decreases the dopamine level in the brain as they block the dopamine channel blockers. That's why the transmission of dopamine from the presynaptic to the postsynaptic is decreased. That's why the dopamine level decreases in the brain, which results in Parkinsonian features. That's why we give anticholinergic drugs, agents to increase the dopamine level in the brain. While in acute dystonia, it happens is sustained muscular spasm which happens, which lead to an involuntary movement. Dystonia can affect the neck, jaw, tongue. Akathisia is a subjective feeling of a muscular discomfort that can cause patients to be agitated. Akathisia can be treated with propranolol, benzodiazepine, and clonidine. Tardive dyskinesia is a delayed adverse effect of antipsychotics. It consists of abnormal, irregular chorioathenoid movements of the muscles of the head, limbs, and trunk. It is characterized by chewing, sucking, grimacing, and perioral movements. Neuroleptic malignant syndrome. This is another type of EPS, type of movement disorder. Neuroleptic malignant syndrome is a side effect where we find if there is, it find within the first couple of weeks, 24 to 72 hours of giving any antipsychotics. It is a life-threatening disease, a syndrome where the seizure is found in the first 10 days of treatment, where there is a generous muscular hypotonia, hyperpyrexia or fever, and high-grade fever, autonomic disturbance like unstable blood pressure, tachycardia, excessive sweating, salivation, and urinary incontinence. Creatine phosphokinase or CPK levels will be raised due to very high levels, Secondary features are pneumonia, thromboembolism, cardiovascular collapse, and renal failure. The symptom lasts for 1 to 2 weeks after stopping the drug. Antidepressants. The classification of antidepressants are MAO inhibitors, TCA inhibitors, SSRIs, and atypical antidepressants. The MAO inhibitors were the first type of antidepressant which were discovered, but it is right now very selectively used, almost none, because of the high side effect. TCAs are used, but they are also selectively used, but while amitriptyline is widely used, because it has been found in the categories and studies that long-term continuation with antidepressants is the best with amitriptyline. The other types of TCA antidepressants are nortriptyline, which is like a brother of amitriptyline, imipramine, which is very much used in nocturnal anorexia, trimipramine, doxepine, dopiapine, and comipramine. While predominant NMDA reactive inhibitors are desipramine, nortriptyline, amoxicillin, and rivoxetine. While selective SSRIs are most commonly used right now, they are escitalopram, citalopram, sertraline, pyroxetine, fluoxetine, and fluvoxamine. While atypical antidepressants or SNRIs or NRIs, which are recently found, non-reactive or all three reactive inhibitors, are trazodone, meanserin, mirtazapine, venlafaxine, duloxetine, tiantreptin, amitriptyline, bupropion, and others. The indications of using antidepressants are depression, depressive episode, dysthymia, reactive depression, secondary depression, abnormal grief reaction or extended grief reaction, childhood psychotic disorders like separation anxiety disorder, somnambulism, school phobia, and night terrors. Other psychotic disorders are panic attack, generalized anxiety disorder, agoraphobia or social phobia, OCD with or without depression. The mechanism of action of tricyclic antidepressants are presynaptic neurons from biogenic amines to Leri's to receptors. From there, it is reacted to biogenic amines. These are synaptic crypt and postsynaptic neurons, as you know. It increases the level of noradrenaline and serotonin by inhibiting the enzymatic breakdown by monoamine oxidase. Some are selective or non-selective and reversible or irreversible. Like in the picture you see, MAO inhibitor blocks the enzyme from destroying the monoamine neurotransmitter. That's why there are more amount of MAO in the synaptic cleft, which helps in decreasing depression. The side effects. The autoimmune side effects are dry mouth, constipation, midriasis, urinary retention, orthostatic hypotension, impotence, impaired ejaculation, while CNS effects are sedation, tremors, seizures, precipitation of mania. The cardiac side effects are tachycardia, ECG changes, arrhythmias. Allergic side effects are there. Metabolic and endocrine side effects, weight gain, special areas of MAO drugs are hypertensive crisis and hyperpyrexia. In a mood stabilizing disorders or mood stabilizers, which we call, they are used to treat in bipolar mood disorders like mania or bipolar depression. The most commonly drug used is lithium. Lithium is used in acute mania or prophylaxis for bipolar and unipolar mood disorder, schizoaffective disorder, psychothermia, impulsivity and aggression, and also to reduce suicidal tendency in schizophrenia and depression patient. How it works? It accelerates presynaptic reuptake and destruction of catecholamines like norepinephrine. It inhibits the release of catecholamines at the synapse. It decreases postsynaptic serotonin receptor sensitivity. All these actions results in decreased catecholamine activity, thus ameliorating mania. The side effects are tremors, motor hyperactivity, muscular weakness, cognitive rigidity, seizures, delirium, coma, renal polydipsia, polyuria, nephrotic disorder, cardiovascular disorder and T-wave depression, gastrointestinal and nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, abdominal pain and metallic taste. Endocrine abnormal thyroid function, goiter, TRE will be there, and weight gain. Dermatological will be acneiform eruption, purpura eruptions, and exacerbation of psoriasis. Side effects during pregnancy and lactation are teratogenic possibility, increasing in the incidence of Epstein anomaly. So it's better to discontinue drug if it is it should not be started during pregnancy. But if there is a bipolar patient who has become pregnant and is stable on lithium, we should closely monitor the patient and try to taper down the dose of lithium as much as possible. Carbamazepine, which is another mood stabilizer, it is indicated in complex partial seizures, in GTCS, generalized tonic-clonic seizures, in rapid cycling bipolar disorder, impulse control disorder, aggression, psychosis with epilepsy, borderline personality disorder, and in trigeminal neuralgia. The average daily dose is 600 to 1800 mg orally in divided dose. The therapeutic blood levels are 16 to 12 mg per ml. The mechanism of action is anti-convulsion action may, however, be by decreasing synaptic transmission. Side effects: drowsiness, headache, ataxia, skin rashes, Stevens-Johnson syndrome, nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, dry mouth, thrombocytopenia and aplastic anemia. Sodium valproate. It is known as the first line of treatment in any type of seizure, basically if the seizure is undiagnosed. It is also used in bipolar disorder. It is indication in acute mania, polylactic treatment of bipolar 1 disorder, rapid cycling bipolar disorder, schizoaffective disorder, and in almost all type of seizures. The mechanism of action: the drug acts on GABA, an inhibitory amino acid neurotransmitter. The doses are usually 15 mg per kg per day body weight, with a maximum to 60 mg per kg per day orally. Side effects are nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, sedation, weight gain, and thrombocytopenia. Anti-anxiety drugs: benzodiazepines, diazepine, pure diazepoxide, oxazepine, lorazepam, alprazolam, clonazepam, and flurazepam. Azapirones are bisperidone, jepiron, and isparipirone. Sedatives are hydroxyzin, barbiturates are amobarbital, phenobarbital, phenobarbital, thiopental. Beta blockers are propranolol. While antidepressants are fluoxetine, fluvoxetine, pyroxetine, esketamine, cetirizine, dapoxetine, and beta-lactam and duloxetine. They all worked as anti-anxiety drugs. Remember, at the end of the day, when the patient is suffering from anxiety, we must give an antidepressant, because these anxiolytics like oxazepam, lorazepam, alprazolam, clonazepam, they can all decrease anxiety, but they are temporary. For long-term treatment and total cure of anxiety patients, we must give antidepressant drugs. But benzodiazepine antagonist of flumazenil is also used as anti-anxiety drug. The indication for benzodiazepines are anxiety disorders, insomnia, depression, panic attacks and social phobia, OCD, PTSD, bipolar 1 disorder, and other psychiatric indications include alcohol withdrawal, substance-induced and psychotic agitation. Here is a picture how this GABA receptor work in a benzodiazepine work in the GABA receptors. Well, there is a GABA subunit where the benzodiazepine acts and it stops the connection of chloride, which leads in increase in the chlorine level in the presynaptic cleft and also in the postsynaptic. So increasing the level of GABA and the increasing level of chlorine. And now we'll come to erythroconvulsive therapy. Introduced by Binney and Carlin in the year 1938. The ECT or shock therapy is artificial induction of a grand mal seizure through the application of electrical current to the brain. Electrodes that are placed either bilaterally in the frontotemporal region or unilaterally on the non-dominant side. Parameters of electrocurrent applied at voltage should be around 70 to 120 amp-volts, duration 0.7 to 1.5 seconds. Mechanism of action is not yet known properly, but it possibly affects the category amine pathways between diencephalon and limbic system. The types of ECT are diet ECT, which is right now banned, which are not given right now, because right now only modified ECT is given, where the patient is under total and general anesthesia and then ECT is given. The frequency and total number of ECT should be given to 6 to 10 average. It can be given to up to 25, maybe preferred as indicated. It should and must only be given in proper ICU settings, and after the patient has been completely sedated with the general anesthesia, we should give shock therapy right now. Indications are given in major depression with suicidal tendency. Trust me, ECT is still now the best treatment. The only one flaw of ECT is that the progress is not permanent, and that's why once ECT is given, most of the time the patient is a patient again has to be given another set of ECT, and post ECT we have to continue the patient with antipsychotic or antidepressant drugs. It is given in major depression. It is given in severe catatonia, in severe psychosis like schizophrenia or mania, with risk of suicide, homicide or danger of physical assault, with depressive features, with unsatisfactory response to drug. There is only one contraindication of ECT, when there is raised intracranial pressure. That's it. There is no other contraindication. These contraindications are there like cerebral hemorrhage, brain tumor, acute myocardial infarction or congestive heart failure. But this is absolute contraindication of ECT is raised ICP. The complication of ECT is very less. basically fractures can sometimes occur in elderly patients with osteoporosis, where there is no general anesthesia not properly given, or the patient was not properly modified, properly controlled. In patients with history of heart disease, dysarrhythmia and respiratory arrest may occur. Signs of OCD are memory impairment, drowsiness and confusion and restlessness, headache, weakness, fatigue or tongue bite. Psychosurgery is a surgical intervention to destroy fibers connecting one part of the brain with another with the intent of modifying behavior, thought or mood disturbances. Indication is severe psychiatric illnesses, chronic duration of illness of about 10 years, failure to respond to all other therapies and high risk of suicide. There are cingulotomy, capsulotomy and subcaudic tractotomy. Is basically very rarely done in India. In cingulotomy, the anglo-cingulate gyrus is been taken out, while in capsulotomy, anterior limb of the internal capsule, while subcaudic tachytomy, substantia innominata is been taken down. Psychological therapies are psychoanalytic therapy, behavioral therapy, cognitive theory, hypnosis, abduction therapy, individual psychotherapy, supportive psychotherapy, group therapy, and family and marital therapy. First, psychoanalytic therapy was first developed by Sigmund Freud at the end of the 19th century. The most important indication for psychoanalytic therapy is the presence of long-standing mental conflicts, which may be unconscious but produce symptoms. The aim of the therapy is to bring all repressed material to conscious awareness so that the patient can walk towards a healthy resolution of his problems, which are causing the symptoms. Transference refers to the patient's development of strong positive or negative feelings towards the analyst, and counter-transference therapist reciprocal response to the patient. Behavioral therapy involves identifying maladaptive behaviors and seeking to correct these by applying the principles of learning derived from the following therapies, like classical conditioning therapy modeled by Ivan Pavlov, which I will teach you later on, or operant conditioning by B.F. Skinner. These are types of learning which we will teach under learning. I will teach you later on. The behavioral techniques are systematic desensitization is done. It is developed by Joseph Wolf based on the behavioral principle of counter conditioning. In these patients attain a state of complete relaxation and are then exposed to the stimulus that elicits the anxiety response. It consists of three main steps: relaxation training, hierarchy construction, and desensitization of the stimulus. Suppose I got a patient, the patient was afraid to, patient was a claustrophobic patient. Claustrophobia. So what I did, firstly, I accompany the patient slowly and let her enter into malls where they are patient, but she was never alone. She always felt protected because I was there with her. From the malls, she couldn't enter into closed places. So I slowly started making her enter into open elevators where the glass is there. And she was alone in the elevator, along with me, only with me. So slowly she got accustomed to this elevator and the closed enclosed places. And slowly she was exposed to closed elevators with people. And slowly this claustrophobia of the patient was slowly recovered. This is one type of behavioral techniques. The relaxation training, there are many methods which can be used to induce relaxation. For me, the best is which I have performed on myself, and I do test it on patients with a very good result, is JPMR, Jackson's Progressive Muscle Relaxation Therapy, meditation or yoga, mental imagery, biofeedback, hierarchy constructions. Here the patient is asked to list all the conditions which provoke anxiety. Then he is asked to list them in a descending order, anxiety provocation, desensitization of the stimulus. At first, the lowest item in hierarchy is confronted. The patient is advised to signal whether anxiety is produced. With each signal, he is asked to relax. After a few tries, patient is able to control his anxiety gradually. As you see the picture, patient is first shown the picture of a spider from a far distance. Surely the picture, the patient is held to keep the picture slow with increased time. Then a spider is actually made to indicate a wave per minute. Slowly it was kept closer. Patient is made to hold it. Patient is made to come close to it. And patient is made to, this is a plastic spider by the way. Slowly the patient is made to come close to a real life spider. And patient is slowly led to closure. This is known as acnophobia. Flooding of the stimulus. Aversion therapy, pairing of the pleasure stimulus with an unpleasant response. Unpleasant response is produced by electric stimulus or drugs like found in alcoholics. We should give before conditioning, we give UCS. I will teach you all about this learning therapy, learning, when I will teach you learning. So during conditioning, we drop food or few drops of metronidazole or some kind of which have a bad taste to the alcohol, which will make the patient nauseating and vomit while after consuming alcohol. This is a way of aversion therapy. Open conditioning, which is done, is a very, it's very close to me. It is for by, because it was actually introduced by B.F. Skinner, whom I respect. They have open conditioning toast, as said, have positive reinforcement, negative reinforcement, and punishment, and in talking of economy. While cognitive therapy, behavior secondary to thinking, self-defeating and self-depreciating patterns of thinking results in a depressive mood. The therapist helps the patient by correcting this distorted way of thinking, feelings and behavior. The cognitive model of depression includes the cognitive triad, like a negative view of yourself, a negative view of the environment and a negative view of the future. These negative thoughts are modified to improve the depressive mood. Hypnosis. Hypnosis is an artificially induced state in which the person is relaxed and unusually suggestible. Hypnosis can be induced in many ways, such as by using a fixed point for attention. The person becomes highly suggestible to the comments of the hypnotist. There is an ability to produce or remove symptoms or perceptions. Group therapy. Carefully selected people who are emotionally ill meet in group. In a group guided by a trained therapist and help one another affect personality changes. Therapeutic factors involved in group therapy, like sharing experience, support to and from group members, socialization, imitation, and interpersonal learning. Thank you. Maybe next class will be taken by somebody else. I hope you all stay safe during these troubled times. Thank you.